university that we don't, you know, preachers or someone to meet, or someone's gonna come here and meet us.
Do you live in Princeton or not?
No, I live in, you know where Whiting is?
Whiting?
Town server. No, town server.
Town server.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know where that is.
About an hour from here.
Okay.
That's where we live.
Do you have a temple there?
No, it's my house. Want to start?
I think they're about to come in.
That's okay.
Yeah.
I think come in. And you play it like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 5.
Hemant, my colleague in the office.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Nice. Thank you for coming. And is your wife?
Yeah, she's.
Do you know chanting Hare Krishna?
Oh, yeah.
You know the mantra?
Yeah.
You need the words or anything?
Yeah, she knows that.
You know the words? And then there's the other mantra we sing behind you there. It's up on the wall. The Panchatattva mantra. The mantra for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You've been to temple before?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. And Adi Prabhu, if you need the words for that.
Yeah, I know that mantra.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Some mantras. carrots for the spoon. Various things. Page 38. Vandana. Vandana means prayer. So you can chant, be along with us. The Sanskrit is there. Follow us. As much as you can. Vande Aham
Vande Guru
Sri Sripad Kamalam Sri Guru Vaishnavam Sya Sri Rupam Sadhujatam Sahagana Raghunatam Vitam Sarvaitam Sarvadutam Parishana Sanatam Krishna Padana Sahagana Vaita Sri Sansanitam Sra Om Ajana Sivirandasya Yajana Salakaya Chakshurum Nirtaniya Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Putra Sri Guru Bhagavandita Mahalalamitaya Sadasada Purva Purva Kambara Prachita Purva Purva Kite Bhakti Yama Yajasya Vritam Samachakam Sadam Vande Shri Guru Devam Ananta Shri Acharya Maryanyam Yorva Pishta Sapurukam Namo Guru Vishaya Bhaktavadutta Murtaye Gauram Vilkarva Dhyaya Radha-Rama-Shemane Vande Bhakti Vinodam Shri Gaura Satya Svamukha Bhakti Shastra Vyasamaja Radha-Rasa Sudhaniyam Bhavaravakashita Sheshaya Vaishnavar Vandiyatiraham Jagannatha Prabhu Vande Premani Vrita Vaishnavam Vajrasara Vardhundyascha Kripa Sindhu Gevacha Vakitana Vahadeva Vaishnavedyo Namo Namaha Vajra Take turns.
Yeah.
Everyone like to participate?
Sure. From where, probably?
Huh?
Which page?
Starting from page
38.
Reading the translation of the prayers.
Sure, probably.
Abhi, would you like to participate in reading?
Sure. I offer my obeisance unto the lotus feet of my guru, the predecessor gurus, the Lord's devotees, Shiva Rupa, Sri Sanatan, Sri Raghunath, Sri Jiva, Sri Rupa's followers, Sri Krishna Chaitanya Dev, Sri Nityananda Prabhu, Sri Advaita Prabhu, Sri Chaitanya Dev's associates, Sri Sri Radha Krishna, Sri Lalita Devi, Sri Visakha Devi, and all of their associates.
Yeah. How would you like to read?
I offer my offerings unto Sri Gurudev, who has opened my eyes, which were blinded by the darkness of ignorance, with the slave of divine knowledge.
I bow my head in eternal obeisance to my Gurudev, the best of Acharyas, Srila Bhakti Namalacharya Maharaj. He is the ever-vigilant, stalwart guardian of the current of pure devotion, whose highest form flows from our most worshipable Sri Rupa Nuga Guru Varga, and their exclusive dedication to Mahabha Srimati Radharani.
I offer my obeisance unto He who perfectly fulfills His Gurudev's most cherished desires, who is fully adorned with the blessings of His Gurudev's associates, who is expert in all aspects of Vedic knowledge, both conceivable and inconceivable, whose preeminent follower of Srila Rupa Goswami Prabhu's line, who is known as Govinda Srila Bhakti Sundara Govinda Dev Goswami Maharaj, whose beautiful, effulgent, exalted form is infused with pure devotion, who is the guru of the entire universe, and who is the giver of the seed of divine love for the Supreme Lord.
I offer my obeisance unto my Lord Srila Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Dev Goswami Maharaj, whose speech is most pleasing, whose divine form is adorned with garments the color of the newly risen sun, who is an abode of intense ecstatic devotion, who is the sadhu's sole choice, who is an ocean of renunciation and knowledge, who is a treasure house of perfect conclusions, who is resplendent with pure devotion, who is the best of Srila Saraswati Thakur's followers, who is the giver of all good, who is the leading general of the Trigandhi sannyasis, and who is my soul shelter.
I serve my Lord, who is known as Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakura. Within the Gaudiya Sampradaya, lineage of gurus, he shines like the sun in the morning sky. Through the Sankirtan of Sriman Mahaprabhu, he becomes the soul's...
He rescues
the soul, engulfed within the belly of the timanyua of illusionism, and bestows upon them the ecstasy of awakening to the nectarian ocean of divine love for Krishna. My vision is going, so please excuse me.
I offer my obeisance unto the divine form of the devotee Avadut Srila Gaura Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj, who is a honeybee at Sri Gaura Sundar's lotus feet and a servant of Srimati Radharani, imbued with deep loving attachment.
I offer my obeisance unto Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur, the embodiment of Sri Gaurasundar Padamsi. He is the king of all notes of the scriptures, of pure devotion and an ocean of the nectar of devotion of Srimati Radharani.
I offer my obeisance unto my Lord, the ocean of divine love, Srila Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj. He is the senior most devotee and worshipped by all who have taken shelter in Sri Navadvipam and Sri Vrajadam.
Again and again I offer my obeisance unto Supreme Lord, Lord's devotee, who are saviors of the fallen, oceans of mercy and wish-fulfilling trees.
I offer my obeisance unto the fivefold manifestation of Sri Krishna known as the Pachatattva. His form as a devotee, Sri Krishna Chaitanya, his expanded form as a devotee, Sri Nityananda Prabhu, his avatar as a devotee, Sri Advaita Prabhu, his pure devotees led by Sri Vas Thakur, and his devotional energies led by Sri Gadadhar Pandit.
Again and again, I offer my obeisances unto you, Sri Krishna Chaitanya, the supreme, merciful, golden form of Sri Krishna, the giver of Krishna praise.
All glory to the merciful Sri Sri Radha Madan Mohan. Though I am lame and wicked, they are my soul's shelter and their lotus feet are everything to me.
I meditate upon Sri Radha and Sri Govinda, being worshipped by their dear girlfriends as they sit upon a throne within a beautiful jeweled temple, beneath the wish-fulfilling trees of divine love of Vardhan.
May Gopinath, the beautiful originator of the Rasa Lila, who stands on the riverbank at Vamsivat and attracts the gopis with his flute song, bestow auspiciousness upon us.
Again and again, I offer my obeisance unto Vrinda Devi, who is known as Tulsi Devi, and Satyavati, who is most dear to Krishna and who bestows devotion to Krishna upon us.
Having offered obeisance to one's initiating guru, to the gurus who have taught on the meaning of the Bhagavad, and to all the authors of Vedic literature who are the gurus of the entire world, proclaim Jai.
Glory to the Lord Vishnu, Sri Puri, Sri Gaura Sundar, Sri Sri Gandharva Govinda Sundar, and all their associates. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare,
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare
Hare. I'll offer one Kala mantra to Srila Prabhupada. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya, Krishna Prasaya, Bhutale, Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Vinaya. Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pratyajane Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Bhakshya Kaladeshatane Sri Ki.
Jai.
Now I'm going to sing a song. And the song of purification. Bhakti Vinod Thakur. Page 105.
Yeah.
Would you like to read? Can you sing?
Yeah.
I have a hard time singing.
Amara jivana sada papirata nahika punyera lesha.
Amara jivana sada papirata nahika punyera lesha.
Arera urvega diachi ekata diachi jivera klesha.
Arera urvega diachi ekata diachi jivera klesha.
Nija shukha lagi pape nahi dhari jaya hina svarta para.
Nija sukha lagi pape nahi dhari dahaya hina swartha para.
Para sukhe dukhi sara mitya basi para dukha sukha khara.
Para sukhe dukhi sara mitya basi para dukha sukha khara.
Asisha khamana hindi maje mora Dhamba Paryana.
Ashisha Kamana Bhuti Maje Mora Dhamba Paryana.
Mada Mata Sada Vishaye Mohita Hinsa Garbha Vibhushana.
Mada Mata Sada Vishaye Mohita Hinsa Garbha Vibhushana.
Nidralasya hata sukarye virata akarye udhogiyami.
Nidralasya hata sukarye virata akarye udhogiyami.
Pratista bhagiya satya acharana loba hata sarakami.
Pratista bhagiya satya acharana loba hata sarakami.
Ehena durjana sajana varjita aparadi nirantara.
Ehena durjana sajana varjita aparadi nirantara.
Shubha karya sunya saranata mana nana dukhe jara jara.
Subha karya sunya sadhanarta mana nana dukhe jara jara.
Ardhate ekhana upaye vihina tate dina akinchana.
Ardhate ekhana upaye vihina tate dina akinchana.
Bhakati vinora prabhura charane kare dukha nive.
Bhakti Vinoda Prabhura Charane Kare Dukha Nivedana.
Amara Jivana Sada Papirata Nahika Punyera Lesha.
Amara Jivana Sada Papirata Nahi Punyera Lesha.
Arera Udvega Diyachi Ekata Diyachi Jivera.
Parera utvega diachi ekata diachi jivera klesha. So, this prayer, of course, you know, of course, in Bengali, of course, and he, Saraswati Thakur, who is the Guru of Prabhupada and also Srila. He said that we should chant this prayer every day to cleanse the mind and cleanse the heart. It's a very humbling song. Generally, people think that they're very, very good. I am a devotee, I'm worshipping Krishna, I God, all these things. But here he's saying, my life is always engaged in sin. Tomorrow, Jivana, Sada, Pop. Tomorrow is engaged in Pop. Not a trace, not a drop, a trace of piety. And I have caused so much misery and dying to others. I like this word, diyachi divera kaisa. You know, when you meet somebody and you ask them, what is your business? What do you do? Anyone ever answer, I just give misery to everybody that I meet. And my business is to give misery to others. Why would we say that? This world, who is attached to this world? A birth and death, old age and disease. If we further entice them, entangle them in this, do something in this world, we're only giving them more misery, encouraging them to accept a world of unhappiness and of death. So whoever encourages or says, oh yeah, I'm this, I'm that, and I'm so many other things, that is encouraging them to find this world is okay. Not the best thing. Not the best advice. Not the best encouragement to give. So even when they think, well, I'm a good man, I go to temple, I go to church, or whatever I do, I help the people, help the poor, and like that. That's not enough. Because that only entangles others, that make this world seem okay. But the devotee wants to go beyond this, transcend. There is a transcendental world, and we're going to read something about this today, and how to get there, and what does it mean? What type of world is that? And how does it differ from this world? So by this diyachi, jivera, so diyachi actually means, and they know, yeah, I give. Jivera means the living entity, and klesha, unhappiness, anxiety, how many pains. By encouraging people in this world, that's our business. Everyone is doing that, an ordinary person. And we don't realize we're giving them unhappiness, pain, anxiety. We should keep it going. My business is to try to get out of here as fast as possible. Bhakti Siddhanta said this material world is like the toilet, the bathroom. You go in and you do your business and then you get out. So, in this world, you have to do your business. Not that you should neglect your duties. You must do your duties. But that not don't make a permanent place here. And not a place where you have to stay for long, the whole life, the whole eternity. Because this life is only one life. Then there's another one after that. Another one after that. Why? Why does it continue on? Of karma. While you do good, you have to get some reward for that. Come back, get some reward. If you do bad, you have to come back, get some punishment, unhappiness. So how do you get out from that karma? Type of karma, action and reaction. Even Newton said that every action there's a reaction. So Veda also tells us, every action, the reaction. And escape that. But how do we then get out from that? How do we get moksha? How do we get liberated from that? So that is the third, actually the fifth in the Buddha Shastras, And when I was in the Puri Sanctuary, that is the fifth goal of life. Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. In Veda, we have four goals. Dharma, do your duty. Dharma, Artha, make a living, make money, make wealth, acquire things. Kama, enjoy yourself, fulfill your desires, and Moksha. And when you are done with all that, then you try to find liberation. But that's not. Here's the fifth goal. That is to develop love, Krishna prema. Love for Krishna. And even beyond, that minimizes even liberation as something that's not so important. That goal, Krishna prema, is more, so much more valuable than even liberation. What to speak of Dharma, Artha, and Kama. It's more valuable than all those other things. What is that? And how do we get there? That's the kind of advice we want to give to people. Not that we don't want to seem negative. Why are you so negative about this one? That's not the idea. There's something so much more valuable to life than just this world. How I cannot tell you about that. And if you are not concerned with that, then you're wasting your time, you know. Not that we want to say don't pay attention to your worldly life. You must do those things. Like marry, children, all parents, all those things, and the society. You must keep them up. Krishna didn't tell Arjuna, don't worry about those things. He did. At the same time, he had to do his duty as a soldier, a fighter. It's a duty or duty. We have to engage in your duty, but at the same time, we have to understand what is the goal of our life. And the fifth element, and how to come to that transcendental pipeline. So, anyhow, so this song is about those who take, are so much absorbed in this world, to realize what they are doing. How their life is being spent in this world. Even if we live a good life, there are so many things that we're doing wrong. So I am never afraid to engage in different activities for the sake of my own happiness. I am merciless and selfish. Nobody ever thinks of others, they think of themselves first. So many people are dying and whatnot, suffering, hungry. Well, we don't think of that. That's merciless. But the point is, what can I do? I have my house, I have my food, I am happy. Selfish. And I am perpetual liar. I may know the truth. I may know, yes, this world is full of suffering. I may not say anything to anyone. Oh, I'm having a good time. I'm happy. And then, that's why. Then I am saddened by the happiness of others. And pleased by the unhappiness. We want our party to win. The other party, they can do whatever they want. Then there are unlimited. Oh, can you read it?
There are unlimited sinful desires within the core of my heart. I am angry and arrogant, always maddened with vanity, infatuated with mundanity, and ornamented with malice and pride.
Now what else?
I am subdued by laziness and sleep, averse to performing good deeds, and eager to perform sinful deeds. I engage in deceitful behavior in pursuit of prestige. I am ruined by greed and constantly covetous. Such a sinner as I is shunned by devotees and is a constant offender. I am devoid of virtuous motives, always intent upon evil, and racked by various miseries. Now aged, I am devoid of any means of deliverance, and thus destitute and distressed. Bhaktivinod submits this remorseful confession at the Lord's feet.
So, we're driven by all these things, and then, but we know they're not good. And that we're not doing the good thing for ourselves or for others. But what can we do? We feel hopeless. So we need the mercy. You know, if we have this mood that I'm not doing the good things, then we don't want justice. Dear Lord, please don't judge me. You don't find I'm worthy of being punished like anything. I don't want that from you. But I don't want your judgment. I need your mercy. The only thing that can help me is you are merciful to me. Look, overlook all the bad qualities that I have. And just with your own love, take pity upon me, glorify me, raise me to your level. There I can have some sanctuary, the help of peace. But I require the upper help, help from above me, beyond me, myself, like a man drowning in the ocean. What do you do?
Yeah.
Where you can reach out, who's going to help you? Only if a boat comes by, somehow by some miracle, and someone is there looking on the boat, oh, there's a man here, let me help you. That kind of help is the only thing we can hope for. Otherwise, finished. You have to come to that kind of. And the thing is this, that Krishna is there. He is there. He's waiting for us just to come to that position. Where we don't depend on our own efforts anymore. We realize that's humbleness. That's humility. And you realize, I'm not going to do it on my own. My dear Lord, if you don't extend your mercy to me, I'm finished. I always remember Srila Prabhupada's journey from India to America. Came on a cargo ship. It was a luxury liner. Came on a cargo ship. He was an old man. He had two heart attacks. And nobody. And he was praying. You're putting me, you're making me do these things. You want this thing from me. And who am I? I'm an old man, I have nothing. So I'm going to a place I've never been, I don't know what to expect. I have nothing there to look forward to. Simply going like your puppet. You're pulling the strings and I am going. Yeah. And what will happen? I have no idea. It's like all the physical difficulties. Yeah. And he began everything. Miraculous. Complete miracle. That could have been done by any old man, could not do that. But because he had emptied himself of himself, he allowed Krishna to come and work through him. And we have accomplished something that no man could have ever accomplished on his own.
He was 65, is it?
Huh?
At the time he was coming, he was 65. How old is he?
60-something.
66.
In 1960s.
66, 65. He came in 65 or 66.
Yeah. Anyhow, that is that's the mood. Any Any questions? You know who Sridhar Maharaj is? You know Sridhar Maharaj? Ever heard of him? You know Prabhupada? You know Saraswati Thakur? But have you ever heard of Sridhar Maharaj, Govinda Maharaj? No. No? This is Srila Prabhupada? This is Sridhar Maharaj. This is in Mayapur. When Prabhupada first opened the Mayapur Chandradaya Mandir, the inaugural ceremony, Prabhupada wanted Sridhar Maharaj to come. He told Sridhar Maharaj, if you don't come, I can't inaugurate my temple properly.
Yeah.
So Sridhar Maharaj was the godbrother. But he accepted him as his Shiksha Guru. He told him, when Saraswati Thakur left this world, Prabhupada had no one to take instruction with. So he took instruction from Sridhar Maharaj, his senior godbrother. And he taught him everything. But Saraswati Thakur taught, he also taught. And so when it was time to inaugurate the temple, he said, Maharaj, please come. And they sat on the Vyasa side together as equals. But Srila Prabhupada always honored him as his Shiksha Guru. You know the difference between Diksha and Shiksha?
Yeah.
Diksha is who gives you initiation. Shiksha Guru is one who gives you instruction. Teaches you Bhagavad Gita, the meaning of all this. That's Sridhar, godbrother, Shiksha Guru of Srila Prabhupada. And Govinda Maharaj is a disciple of Sridhar Maharaj. The picture there on the wall. And the present Acharya in that line is Acharya Maharaj.
Yes.
So Govinda Maharaj, then Acharya Maharaj.
Acharya
Maharaj is the present Guru. And we are the humble servants of Prabhupada and Sridhar Maharaj and all the Vaishnavas. Not so much directly connected with ISKCON, but of course we give honor to them, Prabhupada's organization. And they are going on in their own way. When Prabhupada left, we wanted to have further instruction. And so we went to Sridhar Maharaj to get legals. He was Shiksha Guru of Prabhupada. We thought, in fact, he told us, I consider him my Shiksha Guru. Just think what benefit you can get. If I got so much benefit from him, what benefit you can get? So we took that advice seriously and went there. And we found the same teachings of Srila Prabhupada here, and that inspiration came to us again. And we had with Srila Prabhupada. And we were very happy. So I'm going on. Prabhupada gave me some instructions to preach to the scientists, so that's why I'm here, trying to fulfill his instruction to me. And also with the guidance and mercy of Sridhar Maharaj, Govinda Maharaj, all the Vaishnavas. I'm going on. Who can come here and like to hear these things also? The instructions, the ideas that Sridhar Maharaj taught, I think they can also benefit. They don't criticize anyone, they stand in the Padu. Oh, there also. It's very nice. They have beautiful deities and so many things. All the devotees there are very sincere. Yeah, we offer our tandavats to that. We're not trying to compete in any way. Not a competition. Kind of additional, what do you call, complementary. We want to read, we're going to start reading one book written or compiled, I should say, by Sridhar Maharaj. He also had to leave the Gaudiya just like Prabhupada, because he found they were getting too much into political things. So he didn't want that, he wanted spiritual life. So he left and he started his own mission. And he told one day, he said, well, after he was apart from that, all of that, politicking and institute, he thought to himself, what is the most important thing? What is the most important thing that we are supposed to, we are supposed to understand and learn in spiritual life? And he said, that single most important thing is called sharanagati. Sharanagati, surrender. But he said, if this is what the scriptures is teaching, the most important thing, let me go find throughout the scriptures where that is emphasized, where that is explained. And he collected all these verses.
Mm-hmm.
And there were so many verses, and he thought, well, let me get the most important ones.
Mm-hmm.
And then he compiled his book with all those most important verses on Sharanagati. And he called the book Prapanna Jivanamrita.
Mm-hmm.
Prapanna means surrendered. Jiva, the living entity, Amrita, the nectar in the life of the surrender soul. And that book was first published by Prabhupada's sister. What was her name?
Prabhupada's sister or Sridhar Maharaj's sister?
Prabhupada's sister. First published by Prabhupada. Prabhupada's sister was also very much attached to Sridhar Maharaj as her guru. And she published the book first. It was a Bengali when she published it. And then later when we came to Sridhar Maharaj, we also published that book, an English translation.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're going to read from today. We're starting there. And they're very beautiful because it contains all the important scriptural statements about surrender. So this is the most important thing. Without surrender, spiritual life doesn't even begin. And he's going to explain why, what that means.
Mm-hmm.
Without surrender, then you may be doing things in this world that look like devotion, but they're not. You can't have service in that world without first surrendering your claim over this land, surrendering your existence in this world. And to surrender means to put yourself in a higher hand higher than yourself. Realm higher than yourself. That's what surrender is. If you try to do everything on your own in this plane, that won't be surrender. That won't be connected to that world. That world, that higher world, is the spiritual world. That is governed by, entered into the door. If you enter that, you call Sharanagati. And it's explained that there are three, you could say, three areas. The Vaikuntha, the mundane world, the material world. You know, where Mahavishnu lies down in the tree, the whole material world. That's in the Karana ocean. But at the edge of this world, the material world, there is a river. It's called Varoja. Varoja River is there. Between this world and the Vaikuntha world, there's a river. Varoja or Vairagya.
Mm-hmm.
The Varoja or Vairagya is the plane of renunciation. So this world is the plane of material existence. Then there's the Varoja River, where you renounce this world, and you come to that plane. And then there's the spiritual world. But to get there, you have to go from the Varoja River, from renunciation, to surrender.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to adopt that attitude. Not only to give up this plane, but to go into that plane requires a different attitude. One where that is higher than you. Bhaja. Bhaja, where there's worship. And you worship. Bhaja. Bhajanam. We pray. And that world we have to enter with faith and struggle. And surrender. Without that, no one can say. We remain in this way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyhow, so that's the point that he was making. And all the scriptures that explain that the importance between these he complains that it's the Pramati Naramaka. So I'm going to read now all these things. As I said, I'm going to learn how to get to that platform, how to go enter into it, all the requirements for it, qualifications and stuff. Are you wanting to put this up? They put this on the TV.
Facebook Live.
Pull your chair up. You know, like that, sit on that chair. Very comfortable. You can bring it up so you can see we're going to read on the screen. You can bring that chair up. Okay, we got the chair. Yeah, I'll turn the screen so you can see it. Here is the before is written by because the soul is a particle of consciousness. And now with your will. So what's the difference between a particle, a material particle, and a soul? What's the difference?
Soul has the free will, material particle does not have free will.
Consciousness and free will. Soul has consciousness and free will. Now, a material particle like electron, that doesn't have any consciousness. So, like a stone, say, if you take a stone, small stone, big stone, whatever, and it doesn't have any free will or consciousness. We can take the stone, throw it, and we can calculate where the trajectory, the path the stone will take, and where it will land, depending on how much force we have, and so many other things, right? What planet we're on, the gravitational force, all these things, we can calculate where that stone is going to land. Because it doesn't have any free will, it goes by according to the laws of nature. Strict laws of nature. That's the problem. Now, we take a bird and we throw it. can you predict which way it's gonna go, where it's gonna land? A living bird, not a dead bird.
Okay. Yeah.
Bird, you put it wherever he wants to go, right? There's a difference. A soul and a material particle. The soul has something else. I mean, he has to follow the laws of nature and all that too, but he does it not the same way the soul does. Understand? He has some additional thing. Now, the laws, science doesn't tell us what those additional qualities are or anything about consciousness. We know it doesn't tell us anything, but it only knows about physical. Necessity. Nothing about freedom, nothing about awareness. That's why we don't like Darwin's theory. It makes living entities be like marbles. Like marble, like stones. It makes them up and they become so many different things. It doesn't mention anything about consciousness and freedom. So why we should accept a theory like that about life? Can't be right. If you leave out consciousness, whatever theory you come up with, it doesn't matter. It can't be right if you're talking about dead things. Your only idea of life is some kind of molecule. So we don't accept that. Can't be the correct theory. You have to include consciousness, will, not just fighting one another, and whoever is more, no, there's so much more involved. Intelligence, consciousness, awareness, maybe sometimes they're agreeing, sometimes they disagree. And not just a matter of some kind of formula. We don't know what will happen when people are conflicting with one another, so that kind of theory, we don't appreciate that. Any materialistic theory, we say it's incomplete if it doesn't explain how consciousness is and what it means, and how it interferes, how it acts, how it counts in this worldly existence also. Eliminating free will only grows matter remains. So that's what the scientists, material scientists, are interested in. Only grows matter. An incomplete science. That's what we're here to try to explain in the colleges and so forth. How to include the consciousness, how to include the free will in our estimation of what's going on in this world. You can't just neglect it like that. Think you have understood things properly. Right? Eliminating free will only grows matter in me. Without independence, the soul cannot progress from bondage to liberation. This ultimate salvation would have been impossible. But the spirit of exploitation, let's stop here for a second. So, in Veda, it talks about moksha, talks about some goal, artha, kama, so many things. All those things don't belong to matter. Evolution theory doesn't explain why things progress, why would it go from a little thing to a big thing to a man to a civilization, why that would happen. But they already accept that's happening because there's something more than just matter involved in this world. So there, then it would not be impossible to have all those things that we find in the Vedas. So, independence means freedom. Free will is there. Although he's involved in a world of nature that has so many laws, still he has his independence. So, that it explains here. The spirit of exploitation is a foreign force, an intoxicant, a miscalculation that surrounds his independence. In other words, if you have independence, you can take everything from the environment for yourself. That's called exploitation. Or is there another way? Everyone is here. They take whatever food they need from the environment, whatever people there are, they try to make them their friends and enjoy that way. Or they try to make money, take the resources of nature in some way. All for exploitation for oneself. What other way do we live? Explaining this, but there's a freedom in us, and life's objectives may be scientifically analyzed as threefold. Not only exploitation, there's also renunciation, that's called seeking liberation, and there's also a third thing, dedication, sacrifice, self-sacrifice, giving yourself. That's also there. Not only that, we have to take. Not only do I have to not take anything and just renounce, but we can also have a third option. Common tendency is in those engaged in exploiting other persons, species, or elements for mundane senses. They desire to materially elevate themselves in the present environment, and thus they are described as elevationists. And the more sober class, however, discover the severe equal and opposite reactions to worldly pursuits. They engage in renunciation of the world in search of an equilibrium
comparable to a deep, dreamless slumber. Those who recognize the law of karma, whatever I'm doing to the environment is coming to take from me again. I'm taking something from the environment. Somehow the environment will have to take its, try to reestablish the stasis, the, what do you call it, equilibrium. I'm taking, and it's also taking. Yes. That's the equilibrium. So one who realizes that, oh, wait a minute, this world is like that, I better not do that anymore. That's called renunciation, or liberation. And, but then what do? They want to merge into this dreamless, sleepless, formless, impersonal Brahman. There I won't be in peace. I won't have to deal with this action or reaction. That's the third part. That's the third possibility. The next possibility. Whether exploitation or this renunciation. Opposites. They don't realize there's another alternative, another choice you can make. So although the correct interpretation of the real scriptures is learned by learned rotaries such as Sanatana Goswami, Jiva Goswami, and Ramanuja, the votaries of divinity know the pursuits of both exploitation and renunciation are not only fruitless but injurious to your progress. The normal, wholesome, and happy plane is the life of dedication. Without exploiting or borrowing anything from the environment, and without attempting to artificially renounce it, one who is sincere to dedicate himself naturally comes to contact with a higher and more subtle plane of life. By his readiness to give and serve, he will attain to a higher society and achieve an appropriate master. The enjoying spirit forced one to be associated with the lower section to control and enjoy, and the renouncing spirit allures even the scholars with his prestigious superiority over expectation. Thus it is more dangerous, just as a half-truth, more dangerous than a falsehood. As it is difficult to awaken someone from the deepest possible sleep, deliberations may remain for a calculable time within their cell of non-differentiated liberation, but the higher existence will invite the service of one who desires to purely dedicate himself without remuneration. So this is something people don't think about much. They think either, you find many people who are engaged in the spiritual path, they just want to fast and detach themselves like the yogis. They try to control the senses, control the mind, they detach from everything in the world and just try to concentrate on something higher, where they can be free from all that. That's not the highest. That's not the goal. There is something higher than that. That is the plane of dedication, of bhakti, of devotion, and another way of existing. Totally. Just like when we eat, you're killing. Whatever you eat, you got to kill. I was described in the scripture, jivo, jiva, sajivano. Life requires life for its sustenance. Life requires life for life. You got to take a life in order to have your own life. You don't just eat chemicals.
Yeah.
You got to eat a living thing. So if life requires life for sustenance, whatever, even just to live requires taking karma for yourself.
Mm.
Whatever life is in. Like in the American Indians, you know. Before they would kill something, they would say, my dear brother, I'm killing you this lifetime and eating you. But the next lifetime, I'm going to come and you're going to kill and eat me. They knew it.
Mm.
They were very, very wise, the American Indians. Yeah? And it's also explained in the scripture. Same thing. Now what do you do? How can you manage your life? So, devotees, they say, there's no problem of taking life.
Not me.
But don't take it directly. Huh?
I said, not me.
No meat, but you know, you can take life. Vegetables are also alive. You can take the life, but offer it to Krishna. Bhaktaram pushpam phalam toyam. You can take a leaf, flower, water, anything you want that's vegetarian like that, and offer it to me, and I will accept it because you're doing that with love. And then you take the prasadam. There's no karma for that. not that you don't say, oh, I'm not going to eat because it's karmic, and I get some karma, but it's impossible. And Krishna doesn't make things impossible for us. Take what you have, what you need for your, what you want to, whatever is there, you take that, offer that to me, and then you can enjoy that very nicely. Because you recognize that I'm there. How can, what scientist, I have this sign here, what scientist can make a blade of grass? There's all big scientists, they're going to the moon, there's Mars, the other thing. But can they make a blade of grass? Don't forget about the moon. Can you make a blade of grass? These things, a grain of rice, can you make that? These things are necessary for us. Can you make a grain of rice? No. And who's making that? Where's that coming from? Well, we have to recognize there's something there more than ourselves, to honor that. That's what we call it. That's what we offer. When we're offering food, we recognize that that has come from somewhere, it's been given to us, and to show some gratitude, some love for that. Huh? Yeah, that's the way of proper living. Well, this is a wholesome life, they say. Seva. Service, dedication is the summum bonum of the teachings of the Vaishnava school, the third plane of life. Every unit is a dedicated member in an organic whole. Organic whole. Just like, you know, every part of the body, the liver, the heart, the kidney, whatever is there, the eye, the hand. These are all serving the whole. They're not, each one thing is not competing for its own existence against the others. They're all working together. Not for their own, not just to work together, but for the whole. On behalf of the whole. The whole body is controlling the members of itself. They're all functioning harmoniously. For the sustenance, the growth and development of the whole. But we are like that too. Not that we are all isolated from one another, but we're also part of something. The whole world. The world, we all breathe the same air, we have the same sunlight, everything there. We have reasoning, we can communicate with each other, we understand one another. We have hearts to love and feel things for one another. So there's a unity and there's differentiation too. Because in the body, the heart is not the same as the liver. Kidney is not the same as the nose, and so forth. There's differences, but there's actually unity also. That's what we call universe. Universe means there's unity and there's diversity. Okay? Oh, yeah. So we're part of an organic whole. Although we don't think in those terms, we only think about our individual lives. We have to understand there's something also connecting us. Right? In such a normal adjustment, everyone mutually assists one another in their service to the center, the higher recipient, the highest entity. Everything is existing to satisfy him, because he must possess this qualification to be the absolute. He's the prime cause of all causes, and everything exists for him to satisfy him. Now, this is found in the Veda. Veda tells us about Krishna. That's where we learn. How do we know about Krishna? There in the scripture. So it's given the wise persons. Actually, Veda is not written by any person. It's spoken by God to Lord Brahma and then coming down to the parampara. So that knowledge is given to us. Otherwise, how do we know? We're all satisfied to live in our own way. I think that's fine. But that's ignorance. There is a connection. There's a unity that we're part of. And that we have to try to cultivate that knowledge. That's Vedic civilization. Otherwise, we're living like animals. Animals don't have any knowledge of these things. And they're all depending for themselves. Dog-eat-dog. That's not a wholesome life. These things are for human beings who are a little intelligent, who have a stop. That's why everyone looks a little tired today. Mm-hmm. It's your weekend, they're working hard all week. Not to think so hard. Have a little rest and relaxation. Enjoyment. Also important. But the general idea I try to give, is three things. Exploitation, renunciation, dedication. Exploitation, taking, renunciation, giving up, and dedication. Giving to. And not only giving to as a duty, but out of love. Only love you want to give everything to, automatically. So what do you think? Does it make sense? Make sense? Can you do it? Do you do it?
I try.
Huh?
I try.
You try. Yeah. How about you?
What?
You understand these things? It makes sense to you?
Yeah.
Live our lives, dedicating to this, serving this. When Sanatana Goswami came to Mahabhu and asked him, what am I? Kayami. Who am I? He asked. Kayami in Bengali. Kayami. Who am I? Mahabhu answered, Jivana Swarupoi Krishnara Nityadas. The identity of you and every jiva is to be Krishnara Nityadas, the eternal servant of Krishna. That's your real identity. You want to know who you are? Yeah. Until you understand that, you don't know who you really are. That's who you really are. That's your real identity. And without realizing that, we're living in a false ego, hankar. We're living under a false conception. Therefore, you're not becoming happy. You'll never become happy. You're not being who you are. And you don't know how to be who you are. Puri Krishna. So you start this process of dedication by chanting, using your tongue and your ear. To chant and hear. Shravanam, Kirtanam, that's called. The first principles of devotional service. Devotional activity, first two steps, Shravanam, Kirtanam, and called Vishnu Smaranam. So by coming and listening to things about Kari Katha, about Krishna, that's using your Shravanam, hearing. That's very nice. You're going to be out going to the movies or shopping or anything else. But by coming and sacrificing all those things and coming to here, you're actually engaged in service. It's also service. So it's very nice. Appreciate your effort to serve like that. Anything else? Any questions?
If you are not servant of Krishna, then you cannot be happy.
You cannot. How you can? It's like a fish has water, his house is in water. You put him on the land. Look, there's so many things to do on the land here. Why don't you come here? Very nice, but I'm dying. I'm dying here. Oh, I see you've got Ferris wheels and parks and this, that, and the other thing. We don't have them by where I come from. But if I go on the furnace wheel, I only last a few hours and then finish. I have to be in the water. So like that, we're souls. We belong in the spiritual world. moment you're alive, you're dying another moment.
Yeah.
But you don't belong here. You belong in the eternal world.
If someone said, well, you know, I'm really happy to go to the movies, like you just said, you know, that makes me happy. The whole thing is, it's not permanent. We're chasing all these fleeting, momentary things that make us happy for a second, right? But the eternal thing, the real thing, the bliss, that's what's missing.
Are we losing our real atmosphere? Not in the right atmosphere, only in the exploiting atmosphere. That will lead only to karma. Another death, another birth. I heard this word recently. You heard of rebirth, right? You ever hear of re-death? We have to go from re-death to re-death. That's this material. From re-death to re-death. All right, there you go. My name is sit on the floor if you find it more comfortable.
Do you have to go to the bathroom?